بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We are now in chapter number 3. We spend long time in the introduction of the book, as you remember, because we talk about the methodology of the Aqeedah among the philosophers and among the scholars of Islam. And now we are in chapter 3, which talk about Tawheed, the meaning of Tawheed. Now, Tawheed, this word has come from the verb wahada, okay? Wahad, which means make something one, okay? This is the meaning of wahad. This is why I said wahad, that means one. Wahada, that means to be alone, one. Okay? So this is the word, in the Arabic, when we talk about the linguistic meaning, wahada, to make something one. Tawheed here, that means to believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the real God, the Creator, is one, and there is no more than one God. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is one in His essence. There is nothing like unto Him, and He has no equal. Exalted be He above having a wife or son. So this is what we know, we understand about Tawheed. And we'll talk inshallah in detail about different types of Tawheed. So we talk first about the meaning of Tawheed, and then we'll go to talk about different categories of Tawheed. We'll explain this. قال سبحانه وتعالى قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. The mushrikeen, they came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, ask him, okay, oh Muhammad, tell us about your God. Who is your God? Huh? Who is your God? Okay, what's the lineage of your God? So Allah Azza wa Jal revealed this great surah, surat al-ikhlas. Naam, surat al-ikhlas, sincerity. And this surah, as you know, it's considered as what? One third of the Quran. Why it is one third of the Quran? Because most of the Quran is talk about tawheed, about aqeedah, about the oneness of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He is Allah, He is, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah, the one. Allah, the self-sufficient master. That means He is He doesn't depend on others. Whom all creations need. Allah Azza wa Jal, everybody depends on Allah. And Allah is not in need for anyone, because He is the creator. So Allah is the creator, and everything else is creation. Naam? طيب, He neither eat nor drink, He beget not, nor was He begotten, and there is none co-equal or comparable to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jal is described with attributes of perfection. Remember we talked last time about the rules, when we talk about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we said, what should we, or how can we deal with the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal? بلا تشبيه ولا تعطيل. We believe in all the names, all the attributes that was mentioned in the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, without giving different meaning, without denying any of them or negating them, without distorting the meaning, without thinking about the quality, how, because this is beyond our, you know, comprehension. So we just take it and believe in it, and it is fit His Majesty, and without resembling likeness to anybody else. طيب. قال تعالى ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. There is nothing like Him, and He is the All Hearer, the All Seer. طيب. Allah سبحانه وتعالى alone is the Creator. Nobody creates except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah Azza wa Jal قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. You see those that you worship beside Allah. أَرُونِي مَاذَا خَلَقُوا مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. Show me what they did create of the earth. What did they create? Nobody claims that he created anything. Even the Christian now, if you ask them, okay, who created it? They said God. Jesus is creation or not? Isa alayhi salam? Creation. خلق من خلق الله عز وجل. So everything in this world or this universe, some that we know and some we don't know, is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Azza wa Jal. Nobody ever claim that he create anything. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give very, very, very nice simple example. إن الذين تدعون من دون الله لن يخلقوا ذبابا ولو اجتمعوا له. Those that you worship beside Allah, they will not be able even to create a fly. ولو اجتمعوا له. Even if they get together, all, everyone. You know, let's say, you know, all this superpower, the Russian, American, European, Australian, you know, Arab, non-Arab, everybody, not only mankind, also jinn with them. Give the scientists, Einstein or whoever, let them create fly. Can they do it? The challenge, this for 1400 years, is stand. Nobody till today met this challenge. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ لَنْ يَخْلُقُوا لَنْ تِسْنَ فِي يُسْرَ never create a fly. وَلَوْ يَجْتَمَعُوا لَهُ وَإِنْ يَسْلُبُهُ الذُّبَابُ شَيْئًا لَا يَسْتَنْقِذُوا مِنْ. Not only this, but even this fly, little fly, if it took something from them, they will not be able to get it back. Subhanallah. This fly takes something from you, you cannot get it back. Qudratullah Azza wa Jal. طيب. So, theoretically, the Sheikh said here, it is not enough merely to know that Allah is one. This Tawheed must be reflected in the oneness action, one's action. That means when we act, we should act toward Allah Azza wa Jal as He is one God, and we should not worship except Him. And inshallah, we're coming to explaining, you know, different types of Tawheed, because there are Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, and Tawheed al-Asma wa al-Sifat. طيب. The Sheikh said, the theoretical Tawheed is not sufficient for a person to be counted as a believer. What do you mean by theoretical? That means if somebody said, yeah, I know that God is one, I believe God is one, is this enough to consider him believing Tawheed? It's not. This belief should be what? Reflected in what? On your action. Otherwise, it's just word to say. طيب. So he must also take Allah alone as his God and object of worship. Allah Azza wa Jal is the only one should be worshipped. The word God, my dear brothers, be careful. The word God is different from the word لفظ الجلال Allah. The word God, you can call it as a title, طيب, or as a word to describe whatever worshipped. Whatever worshipped. There are some people, their God is cows. They worship cows. Some people, they worship idols. They are gods. Some people, they take Jesus as God. Some people, they take mountains, you know, fish, whatever. God, God. So when we go to English, you know, what they do, they put the capital letter, G, to show you that this is the true God. And then the small one, that means other God. So God doesn't mean Allah. It's mean Ilah. It's mean Ilah. This is the word. God means Ilah. And this word, God or Ilah, it could be plural and could be feminine. Like, you know, if you go to the Roman, they have different gods, female gods. And there are also, they say goddess. And they said gods with S, that means plural. But when you come to the word Allah, look at this beautiful name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot make gender, you cannot make plural, and it's come from where? From the heart. Allah. You see, your lips doesn't move, your tongue doesn't move. Allah. From here. See? Subhanallah. So this is a word specially for whom? A name for Allah Azza wa Jal. No one ever claimed that his name is Allah. Nobody. This is why, even at the time of Jahiliyyah, before Islam, Allah mentioned this in the Quran, many ayat. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتُمْ مَنْ خَلْقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. If you ever ask them, who was the one who created the heaven and the earth, they said what? Allah. They will not say Allah to Al-Uzza or these idols. Even they worship them. They know the creator is Allah. So to say that Allah is the creator, therefore he is the real God that should be worshipped. And those that you worship beside Allah, they have no power to help you, to assist you, to reward you, to punish you, to harm you, to benefit you. Nothing. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is, because the creator, the provider, the bestower of blessing, the giver of bounty, the giver of life and death. No one can give life except Allah azza wa jal. Nobody can cause death except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who bears the attributes of perfection and is far above any shortcomings. The sifat of Allah, as we mentioned before, even sometimes with, it take the same names. Like when you say wajh, face, wajh, it has a meaning for the people, right? But that does not mean it's similar to any other face. Something which is fit his majesty. Yet, his hand. He had hand. We talked about this before. He mentioned in the Quran that he has two hands. How? Allahu alam. We don't go to how or resemble it or likeness or anything. So it's perfect and above our imagination. Everything and everyone else is subject to his lordship and divinity. What does this mean? You see, rububiyyatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala lil-khalq of two types, general and specific. General rububiyyah, rububiyyatun amma. What does this mean, general? That means he is the lord of every creation, of every human being, believer and non-believer. He like it or he didn't like it. His Lord is Allah. Why? Because he's the one who provided him. Right or not? He's the one who created him. He's the one who gave him. He's the one who protected him. He's the one who gave him this life, this wealth, everything in this world. Right? At the same time, he cannot run away from the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Cannot run away. The circulation of the blood in the body of the human being, it's not under his control, right? Who's the one who runs this circulation? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The beating of the heart, it's not in your hand. So you are under control of Allah azza wa jal. You like it or you didn't like it. So Allah is Rabb, your Lord. This is general. So Allah azza wa jal is, this is the sense of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, the Lord of everything, no matter what this one claim, because he's the one, Allah Azza wa Jal, the only one who created you and provide you and protect you and give you. The general. But there are what we call it special rububiyyah. Special. Rububiyyatun khassa. This special rububiyyah, for those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give them special. What is the specialty? They are a believer. Since they are a believer, they will get some thing that others they will not get it. What are they? Guidance, mercy, forgiveness, take them from troubles at the time of troubles, get them in paradise, and thereafter they will be honored with reward in this life. They will have happy life, peaceful mind. All these cannot be found except for, cannot be given except for whom? For the believer. For the real Muslim who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and, obey Allah azza wa jal. طيب. So everything and everyone is subject to lordship and does not have the power to cause harm or bring benefits instead, as we mentioned there. Now, so how can it be worshipped instead of Allah? Like, if you know that everything, your faith and everything that you have is given from Allah, and then you will return to Allah, then just think about this. And He's the one who judges you. How come you go and worship somebody else? Just logic. Right? So the contradiction of those who do not worship Allah alone, the kuffar, disbelievers, from the mushrik, idolaters. Right? What is the difference between mushrik and kafir? Every mushrik kafir, right? Every mushrik is kafir, because disbelief includes everything. Anyone who deny Allah or who worship somebody beside Allah. The mushrik is subcategory. The one who worship Allah but with somebody else. He has a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like awliya, like rabbis, you know, like angel or like prophet. He said, I believe in Allah, but I, you know, I worship or I call open so-and-so to get benefit. You see the question that somebody posed in our group. Did you read it? I wish that you read it carefully. And you see the answer that I posted. You see, this is the confusion of some people. What they do, they bring to you a hadith. And from this hadith, they conclude different conclusion, which is not correct. As they like. So this guy is, you know, that what he, this from the Sufis and the Rafidah sometimes. They do this. So they said, look, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see, he makes shafa'ah, intercession, for his uncle Abu Talib in the Day of Judgment. So he will get him from the heavy punishment to the light punishment. You see, and then look at the conclusion. The misguided conclusion. See, you see, the Prophet, he has a power. He can benefit. He can, you know, help. You see, he helped his uncle, and his uncle is a kafir. How come he cannot help you? You're a Muslim. Look, so they talk. Subhanallah. The conclusion is wrong. Because this was, you know, an honor of intercession. Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet, he cannot do it without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it was specified for this person. By the, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he can do benefit, why he didn't give him guidance when he was alive? Right or not? It was very, but all the matter is in the hand of Allah. And the Quran is telling us, right, that Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, that I cannot benefit even myself or harm. لا أملك نفسي ضرا ولا نفع. I cannot have even for myself any harm or benefit except what Allah عز وجل bestowed on me. ولو كنت أعلم الغيب لاستكثرت منه. If I know the future, then I will get more of the goods. وما مسني السوء. And no harm, nothing will touch me. He's telling us this. Why? To show you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with all the love, we love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the best of all creation. He is the one that we take him as an example. He is the one that we love him more than ourselves, our family, our children, our wealth, about everything else. We sacrifice our life, you know, in his love. But at the same time, we should understand that he is messenger of Allah. He is a human being, as mentioned in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said what? Qul, say, innama, I'm not more. Look, innama, I'm not more than what? Basharun, a human being. Mithlukum, like yourself. What else? What the extra? Yuha ilay, revelation comes to me. This is the difference between me and you. And then what the ayah say? فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُوا لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ. The one who really want to the meet of Allah, to believe in Allah, to get the reward of Allah, what should he do? Should he worship me or ask me? فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا أَنْ وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِرَبِّيَ سبحان الله. Do good and don't associate any partner with Allah. So this conclusion, it was wrong. So the Prophet ﷺ, in this world, we should not call in the Prophet ﷺ, oh Muhammad, help me. Oh Muhammad, assist me. We ask Allah to give the Prophet ﷺ permission to make shafa'ah for us. So we turn to whom? To Allah alone. You got the point? This is very, very important. Yes. Murtad. Yes. Murtad. I mean, the Murtad is the one who embraced Islam, or he was a Muslim, and then he apostated. That's what they call it, apostasy. That means he he disbelieved after the belief. This is called Murtad. That means he retained. Subgroup of the Kafir. The minute that he leave Islam, he will be considered as Kafir. As Kafir. مرتد. This is the word مرتد. نعم. طيب. The contradiction of those who do not worship Allah. So, this was an appalling contradiction for the one who is unique in his power of creation, the only one deserving worship. Submission. طيب. The Quran debates it at length with the mushrikeen and pointed out their contradiction. It explains that what they believed about his being unique in his power of creation and provision, etc., obliged them to worship him alone and direct their deviation solely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the argument of the Quran always with the mushrikeen, disbelievers, at the time Prophet until today. The Quran always, why the Quran is always emphasizing that you should look around you, who created this, who gave this, who's the one who providing, who the, and said Allah, Allah, Allah. Then the logic say what? That you should worship the one who do this, not worshiping idols or somebody will not benefit. طيب, كلمه التوحيد. And we just to give introduction and we'll leave, inshallah. كلمة التوحيد, the word of توحيد. كلمة means word. كلمة means word. التوحيد, their meanings, virtue and condition. This will be our subject in detail, inshallah, next week. But let's say, just go to the meaning. The word توحيد, لا إله إلا الله. There is no God except Allah. If we took it literally, say, لا إله, no God, إلا الله, except Allah. This is the literal translation, but this is wrong. نعم, because if you say there is no God except Allah, this is in the sense of people is not clear, because they say no, there is many gods, people worship, right or not? Therefore, here we need to add something to explain it. Not real God. There is no one worth to be worshipped. No true deity, except Allah. لا معبود بحق إلا الله. This is the meaning of لا إله إلا الله. لا معبود بحق إلا الله. None worth to be worshipped or have the right to be worshipped except Allah سبحانه وتعالى. طيب. Sums up and this phrase is the login of basis of Islam. We know that. La ilaha illallah. The first word that man should say when he come to Islam, and the last word that Muslim should say before he leave this world. To show you the importance. So the meaning of this phrase is, there is no God deserving of worship except Allah. Those who interpret it as meaning that nothing exists except Allah are mistaken. Because as we said, there are other people who have their own gods. So we cannot no gods exist. There are, but they are false. Right. So according to those people, the meaning would be there is no God that exists except Allah. And this is incorrect, because then it would imply that everything that is worshipped, rightfully or wrongly, is Allah. This is the point here. Because somebody say it this way, na'am, that means, well, everything is worshipped, that means it's part of Allah. Ta'ala Allah, amma yaqudun. See, this must not be said. Na'am? Because we cannot mix with Allah Azza wa Jal and His creation. This is what they call it, the mixing. The people who they say, Allah is in everything. Na'am? هذه الفكرة الوجودية والحلول طيب like those who said Allah is everywhere. That's wrong. Allah is everywhere with His knowledge. Be careful. With His knowledge. God knowledge. نعم. Not His existence here. طيب. So there is no God that and then which would mean that all that mushrikeen worship, like the sun, the moon, the stars, if somebody say that, you know, everything is Allah. Allah, it is if they were saying that nothing is worshipped in this manner except Allah, which is the false and false. This is false. That means everything is worshipped, consider Allah. That's wrong. The sun is a creation of Allah. The moon is a creation of Allah. And these objects are what? Worshipped by some people. But this doesn't make it as God. As like, you know, when we talk about Jesus Christ, and peace and blessing upon Him, does because there are some people who worship Him or consider Him as a son of God, does this make Him God? It doesn't make Him God. But this is the false belief of some people. There are texts which indicate the virtue and great benefit of the phrase La ilaha illallah. For sure, inshallah, we'll talk about some of the fruits of La ilaha illallah and some of the speciality about this word. طيب. We have quoted above the text which indicate that whoever say La ilaha illallah sincerely from his heart will enter paradise. من قال La ilaha illallah مخلصا من قلبي دخل الجنة. Promise. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying what? Whoever say لا إله إلا الله sincerely from his heart, he will enter paradise. طيب. And from this we know that, brothers, that anyone who believe in لا إله إلا الله, no matter what he did in this world, he will not abide forever in the hellfire. You know, he may be punished, for some sin, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him, may by the intercession of some, you know, the Prophet or some of the Salihin at that time, Allah give him permission. So, same like the hadith that I mentioned in the answer, my answer in the group. So they will be out. So here to show you the fruit of La ilaha illallah. But it should be what? Sincerely from the heart. Na'am? And this is why the person, when he say it, at the last word, he will enter paradise if he say it. But we should understand that it's not just verbal word as some people they think. Somebody say, Ya la ilaha illallah. Okay, la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Alhamdulillah. Tayyib. Do you pray? No, they believe in the heart. I always say, La ilaha illallah. When I wake up, I say, La ilaha illallah. When I walk, when I go, La ilaha illallah. This will not benefit him. Because it's not just word to be said, but it's to believe. That should come from the heart. Type. So by this statement, this word, person, wealth, and blood are protected and person become Muslim. This is the rule here. Difference between the rule and the judgment of the heart. What does this mean? Now, if somebody come to us and said, La ilaha illallah, we should look and treat him as what? As what? As a Muslim. Right or not? As a Muslim. He said, La ilaha illallah. He will be dealt with as Muslim. Is he really Muslim? This is something, will be left for whom? Allah to judge. Like the munafiqin, the hypocrite at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Huh? نعم إذا جاءك المنافقون قالوا نشهد إنك رسول الله. When they come to my hypocrite, they say نشهد أنك رسول الله. We testify that you are the messenger of Allah. Allah عز وجل said what? والله يعلم والله يعلم أنك رسول الله. Allah knows that you are his messenger. والله يشهد إن المنافقين لكاذبون. And Allah testified that those men, when they say this word, they are liar. Because what? They say it with their tongue, but their heart is not believe. They don't believe in this word. طيب. But for the Muslim, be careful, my dear brothers. This is very, very important. This is why, subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during his lifetime, even there are some hypocrites, they know them by names. Even though he didn't tell anybody about them. And he gave this name to Hudayb ibn al-Yaman, one of the Sahaba. He knows the names as a secret. And he never told him. And the Sahaba, they know that he knows the names. Even though he didn't tell the Sahaba about, look, this is Munafiq. Why? This not open the gate for everyone to use his own judgment. So people, when they argue, they say, ah, this is Munafiq, don't pray on him. Don't make salah to him. Don't eat his meat because he's a Munafiq, he's a kafir. Astaghfirullah. طيب. Usama ibn Zayd, you know Usama ibn Zayd, radiallahu anhu, one time was in a battle. And there is one, you know, person who was fighting very hard, and he killed some of the Muslims. Till Usama, he was in a position that he was able to kill him. So when he catch him, that man, what did he say? La ilaha illallah. Usama, as a human being, said, ah, he said it because he's afraid. Now the sword is in your head. So he killed him. So he came to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ was very angry with him. He said to him, what will you do, huh, with La ilaha illallah? He said, oh, Prophet Allah, he said, because he was fearing, because I want to. He said, how did you know? You know that, you know, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that even Usama that day, he said, I wish that I embrace Islam after that day. Because he did this. So the point is, we should not judge people and say this is a hypocrite, this is I. It's not for us. So that those who claim they are Muslim and say La ilaha illallah, we deal with them as Muslim. They marry Muslim women, huh? They, you know, we eat their any slaughtered animal they slaughter. طيب. When they die, we take them to the grave. We pray everything. Even they are hypocrites. When their, you know, reality will appear and the day of judgment. At that day, the hypocrite will go with the believers. They think it's the same story. Huh? Like, they, you know, they trick the believers here, so they think they can trick in the hereafter. And when they are walking in the darkness, judgment, so the believer, because of their belief, Allah gives them light. So they walk. Those munafiqeen, they walk with them, but they have no light. So they said, "Unzuruna naqta bismillah." Wait for us, huh? We'll walk with in your light. Said, it will be said to them, "Arji'u wara'akum, faltamisu nura." Go back and get nur. Can they come back to this world to get the nur or light of belief and iman? They will not. فَضُرِبَ بَيْنَهُمْ بِسُورِ اللَّهُوبَ. At that day, they will be divided. They know the truth. That, and this is why Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Huh? المنافقين يخادعون الله وهو خادعهم." Those hypocrites, they think they deceive Allah, but in fact they deceive themselves. So we'll stop here, inshallah. And so, to conclude, we say that it's not just a word to be said, La ilaha illallah. But there are certain conditions that we should know it. We should understand it, we should practice it, we should apply it in our life, otherwise will not benefit from this word of shahada. So inshallah next week it will be, we'll talk about the conditions of la ilaha illallah. Barakallah feekum. Have any question?
Yes.
Yes.
In general, this, is it true that all non-Muslims are not kafirs, only who reject the message, they are the kafirs?
What do you mean? Give me the question.
And they gave message to Tawheed and all, we tell Allah.
Nah.
Pray, worship Allah and all.
Nah.
In case the non-Muslim rejects the message, then he's called a kafir?
Yes. If he didn't accept, you see, if he said, they say, I believe in Allah, okay, then you should believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no, but Muhammad, I'm not sure that he's a Muslim or not. Then he's a kafir. Okay? Or even he said, I believe in Allah, I believe in Muhammad, I believe in the Quran. And then he has some doubt about what the revelation or anything which is in the Quran or the Sunnah, then we'll continue. Anyway, this will become, inshallah, in details when we talk about what are the things that nullify la ilaha illallah. All the, it will come, inshallah, in detail. Yes?
Abdullah ibn Ubayy, nah.
Yes, yes. Yeah, this is a good example. You see, Abdullah ibn Ubayy ibn Salul, this was the head of the munafiqeen. And the Quran mentioned some of the things that he did to the Prophet, to hear the Prophet and the Sahaba. Huh? Like for example, saying, قال لئن رجعنا إلى المدينة ليخرجنا العز منها الأذل. He say it. طيب. And the Prophet knows, and the Sahaba themselves, they know that this is the head of munafiqin. Even though the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was dealing with him as Muslim. When he died, huh? He went and he put his, even he gave his shirt to his son to put it under. Why the Prophet did this? He did it because of his son. His son is very righteous believer. That even he, one time he came to the Prophet, he said, O Prophet of Allah, please, if you want to kill my father, let me do it myself. I'm afraid that if he was killed by somebody else, then I will think this is the one who killed my father, and then I will kill him, then I will be in trouble because I'm killing, you know, believer. Because so the Prophet ﷺ, he didn't, he said no. See? So the Prophet ﷺ, he went there and make dua and pray till Allah Azza wa Jal revealed to him. وَلَا تَقُمْ وَلَا صَلِّ عَلَى حَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدٌ وَلَا تَقُمْ عَلَى قَبْرِهِ. Allah Azza wa Jal revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, don't ever stand and make dua for them and make prayer for any of them. So the Prophet ﷺ was, he was informed. So he doesn't, there's some person, he doesn't pray. And you know, because they are hypocrite. But for us, this another good example that how even the Prophet ﷺ, he knows the names of the munafiqeen, but deals with them as Muslim. So for us who don't know, how can anybody come and accuse of any person who say la ilaha illallah, and he seems pray, and he claims that he is Muslim, and say, no, you are not a Muslim, you are munafiq. Who told you this? This is, my dear brothers, very, very, very serious matter. And this is a problem of this fanatic group who are killing Muslim. They are killing Muslim, justifying this bloodshed and killing Muslims in the name of Islam, while in fact they are judging people without knowledge. It's not correct. This is something that we should teach our children, teach our brothers. We should not judge people just because, as long as somebody come and say he's a Muslim, then we should take it as a Muslim.
So, Sheikh, I have one clarification, because yeah, nowadays the issue mainly in the Philippines, or not actually in the Philippines,
yeah,
the issue of, for example, if you see some groups or some people who are knowledgeable in Islam, but they believe, is that actually in our dissimulation of our Aqidah, mm-hmm, how can we judge them? Because it's actually very clear that they are following the path of not Aqidah of us. So how we could judge them?
Okay, just
in a right way.
Jazakallah khair. This is very important.
And like bid'ah, something like
that. Okay, you see, hear the point here. We talk generally here. Generally, anybody who claims that he's Muslim will be taken as Muslim. Look at as a Muslim, as a believer, right? unless he did something or say something which is contradict with the belief. Like for example, somebody said, I am Muslim. Okay, alhamdulillah, accept. But then he said, but I believe only in the Quran. The Sunnah, I don't think that is important. He said, huh? If you say this, then you are out of Islam. You got it? Here? So I'm not judging the person just by the person, but because of the action that he did. Okay? A person that said, I am Muslim. He pray, he make dua, he make everything, but every Friday or any other, he go to one grave and he make prostration and he call this and he said, well, this, you know, I don't worship him. I believe in Allah. I am Muslim. I am following Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I do this, so this is wali. This is a very righteous person. Will get us closer to Allah azza wa jal. We say, no, this is shirk. This will get you out of Islam. Why? Because this is shirk. What's the difference between you and the people of Jahiliyyah? The people of Jahiliyyah, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did they say? قالوا ولا وما نعبدهم إلا ليقربونا إلى الله زلفى. We don't worship them except the reason is to get us so they get us closer to Allah. And Allah called them mushrikeen. See? So here the point is, as we say, generally speaking, whoever claims that he's a Muslim will be accepted as a Muslim unless he did or say anything which is contradict with the meaning of believing Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right? And this all, inshallah, will come when we talk about the nullification. What are the things that nullify the meaning of La ilaha illallah? Right? Jazakum Allah khair. See you, inshallah. Yes?
When we send salams to Rasulullah,
sallallahu alaihi wasallam,
do we get a reply back?
Yeah, there is a narration. Mm-hmm. There is a narration. Whoever come to the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's hadith, right? The Prophet will respond. How? Allah knows. This is something of the ancient there, something beyond our this world.
Some based on that, they say some say he's alive.
Naam?
Some say based on that thing, some say he's alive in the grave.
Alaykum as-salam?
He's alive. He has life, still life in the grave also. So he replies back.
This, you see, as we said, whenever you are talking about something of the other world, it has its own rules. We don't know. But we took this from the narrations, the revelation. So there is a hadith. I need to check about this hadith in detail and how did the ulama understood this hadith. Because there is a hadith that said, whoever says salam to me, Allah will return to me my soul, and then I will say, respond to his salam. Okay, but it doesn't mean that he is living in the sense that we understand it. Everything in the grave is different thing. We know that, for example, people in the grave, either in Jannah or what? In hell, right or not? Either they are enjoying or not. How? Allah knows. Now, if you go to any graves and get, you will find bones, you will find. You don't see no paradise, no hell. But since the revelation is telling you that there is, then we believe in this, because this is something beyond our knowledge and imagination.
Wa iyyakum.
So see you inshallah next week. Jazakum Allah khair.